Dear Heavenly Father, again, we humbly come before you, and we're so thankful for your Son. We're thankful for the wonderful gift that you gave. We didn't deserve it, but yet you gave it to us, and literally history pivots upon the birth of your Son, and we're so grateful for that. We ask you would just be with those that are traveling this morning. There's so many of us that are driving around. Just keep everybody safe. We ask you would bless those that have come here this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 If you know the song, you sing right along. Mark, go ahead and let's kick it off. And Merry Christmas, everybody.
Yeah.
most wonderful time of the year. We sing that song, or you hear it on the radio 100 times, and that is a great way to, interesting way to start, because my sermon is really impacting. If you think about the Christmas story, how it impacts us, we think about it and focus on it this time of year, but we forget the impact sometimes the rest of the year. You think about when you're out and about, you get right to Christmas, Christmas Eve, the day before, everybody kind of chillaxes, mellows out, and kind of really focuses on each other. And why can't we have that same feeling all year long? How come we got to wait until this time of the year? So the impact of the birth of Christ is so impactful that it really changes culture, even just for a short time. Our jaded culture that we have across America and across this world, for a short time, it gets focused and it changes. And it's really interesting to see. And that was just kind of a fun song to kind of plug in there. Just quick announcements. There's no Bible studies or anything for until we get to January. We got the ladies starting January 13th, and it's still at Ruthie's, right?
It's still at Ruthie's.
All right, so ladies, think about that. Ladies, I really encourage you, as we always do, if you know somebody that would benefit from that, bring them along. They don't have to come to church to be a part of that. Also, we've got in the back by the offering box, we got Connect cards. And those we want you to fill out. If your email changes or your contact information changes, or if you haven't done it and would like to keep updated with what we're up to, please fill that out so we can keep you updated. We do send out, if we have weather issues or whatever going on, we do send out information to y'all, and so we'd like you to have it. We've got tithes and offering, different ways you can do that. You can check it out in your bulletin or ask one of us, we'll help you with that. And the Christmas, obviously we're at Christmas Day, so we don't, that's our announcements for now, right? Exciting announcements. Just quickly, next week, it'll be New Year's, a whole year from now. You won't have to deal with me until next year after this service. It'll be awesome. But New Year's Day, we will be here at 10 a.m. Love to have you here. Again, they didn't listen very well, but the rules are on when it falls on Christmas Day and New Year's Day, I don't want anybody in the building till at least 9:30. And I got here at 9:35, and there's a lot of cars out here. So what time did y'all get here? Early. We want you to enjoy family and friends and whatever you guys do on New Year's Eve, and just wander on in on New Year's Day as we start a new series in 1 John. So we're excited about that. We've got a short video I want to play. I want to keep the service kind of keep it moving and going along. Is the next song, do we get to sing along with you?
You do indeed.
All right. So while we're singing, as soon as the video's over, I'd like you to grab, we didn't get to do candlelight service last night, so we thought we'd do it at the end of the service this morning. We'd end the service with Silent Night. So if you haven't grabbed a candle, I'm going to pass them out while we're singing.
Thank you.
Stay standing.
Job. Turn with me in your Bibles. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 1. We're going to start in verse 18. We're glad to have you here this morning. Thanks for taking some time out of everybody's busy Christmas schedule to come together and worship our Lord. Hey, Mark, is it possible to get the center lights down? That'll help me with my old eyes. You'll read a little bit. We think about the impact of the Christmas story on our culture. Really, the coming of Jesus Christ really changed history, and we've talked about that. We're talking about new beginnings, really the new beginning as we think about what Christ has done for us. I like the Christmas Carol. You guys are familiar with it. I don't know if not too many people have actually read the book. Or read the story. I do about every 2 or 3 years. I've got an illustrated version of a story. It's a short read, a couple sittings. You can have the whole story read. You've probably seen the movies. There's several really good movies that really stay true to the work. And everybody knows Ebenezer Scrooge. Don't be a Scrooge. It's kind of bah humbug. It's in our lexicon. And I love that story. Just that whole idea of redemption. Scrooge starts as a character that's not to be really to be loathed, but at the end, he sees the light and changes. And really, that's what Christ does in our lives. It changes us from rebelling against him to having a close relationship with God. There's an exchange between, at the beginning of the story, between Scrooge and his nephew. And his nephew comes in and just wants to make a connection with his uncle. The only family he has left is his uncle Scrooge, and Scrooge just kind of blows him off. And I'm going to kind of paraphrase the exchange, but the exchange goes something like, Scrooge is, his nephew always invites Scrooge over for Christmas dinner, and Scrooge never comes. And Scrooge says to him, "You celebrate Christmas in your way, and I'll celebrate it in mine." And his nephew retorts back and says, "But you don't celebrate it. You don't let it change you," is kind of the exchange. And he goes back and he talks, and at the end of he explains why Christmas is important to him. And he's got this great line towards the end. He says, "It hasn't put a scrap of gold or silver in my pockets, yet it's changed me. Yet I want more of it. And God bless Christmas," he says at the end of my paraphrase to that. And that's really kind of, I like that exchange because it's about changing. Christmas, in some ways, in our culture, has become about, you know, presents and Santa Claus and all those type of things. But at the heart of it, it's about change, and it's about what direction we're going to go in our lives. Look at our story, and I want you to focus on last night. We were going to talk about the humility of Christ coming down, the humility of Mary and Joseph, and how they're just humble. And notice that humility that you just see in the story as we kind of read through it. Matthew 1, 18. "Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and she'll call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet: 'Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which means God with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus." This morning, as believers, we can trust that God is in control, which gives us confidence to pursue his grand design for our lives. I titled this "The Answer." It's like sometimes people wonder, what's the bigger plan in my life? And you'll see with our relationship with God, our purpose becomes clear. As we celebrate the birth of our Savior, we can experience the provisions of God's grace and purpose in our lives. This morning at my house, everybody got up. We had a couple new characters that were along. A couple of the girlfriends were here this morning with our boyfriends, or with our boys. And it's the first time we've had them come over in the morning to unleash the Christmas chaos, which is our household. Debbie and I have the presents for the boys all laid out, and we had them for the girls too, and they hadn't quite experienced that. So it's like 1, 2, 3, go. The dog jumps in the pile. Everybody's starting to open their presents, and it's just chaotic. I love it. The dog, she thinks she can open presents, so she tears at anybody that's moving out of a box. She grabs at the box and fights them for it, and it's just total chaos. And the girls were kind of like, we've never seen anything like this. And that's beautiful. It's controlled chaos, so to speak. Everybody's got a mission. They're opening their boxes and they're going through things, and it's a lot of fun. It lasts a very short amount of time because the chaos goes quickly. But we make plans in our lives, and as we make plans, often God laughs at those plans. I've had that several times. You've heard some of my stories over the years. You think you're going to go this way in life, and when you really allow God to get a hold of your life, it changes. Now look at our story this morning. We're going to see a huge change. What Joseph and Mary had planned, they're betrothed together, they're going to get married. What they had planned is not what God had them go. And we get to watch Joseph and Mary as they react to this change, this God change in their life in a powerful way. So let's look at it a little bit. Joseph had this plan, and so he's betrothed to Mary. And what that means, if you're not familiar with it, it's a term back in Jesus' time that you would be, it's kind of like a long engagement, but it's different because you're technically almost legally married for about a year or so. And in that time, you prepare as a couple, and then you have, about a year later, you have the official marriage part of that. You stay apart for that time. And it's a legally binding. You're married technically, but you haven't moved forward with that. There's no physical contact until the betrothal period would be over. And notice it. So Joseph, because they're kind of legally married, they're traveling to Bethlehem to pay their taxes and be a part of that. And so they were committed to leave Nazareth and then return. And so I kind of mentioned this because you're kind of clear, you kind of know the story. The reason they're in Bethlehem is not what they would have wanted, but that's what the government needed for them to go there for the census and to pay taxes. And then the plan was for Joseph to return. They would finish that time of betrothment and get married officially, and they would start their life together, maybe in carpentry. We don't know what Joseph did, but that seems like what he did, would go back to the business of carpentry. And that was his plan, kind of the American dream in that version, right? He's living the dream. That's his dream, right? That's his plan. But God all of a sudden throws a huge monkey wrench in it with Mary becoming pregnant with the baby Jesus. We see God's plan. Joseph was to provide and protect for the Savior. Look in our story. The angel comes to Joseph, and his mother Mary had betrothed Joseph. Before they came together, she was found to be with child in the Holy Spirit, and her husband Joseph, being a just man and willing to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. You can see that in Joseph, we see character. We're going to explore that character here in a bit. But God's plan for Joseph was so much bigger than what he expected. And verse 20, and he considered these things, and behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear and take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. And she will bear a son, and she'll call his name Jesus, for he will save the people from their sins. Now all of a sudden, his plans are totally going sideways. God sends an angel to talk to Joseph and say, look, Mary's pregnant, but she hasn't done anything wrong. Now understand the magnitude of this. Joseph and Mary were to provide for Jesus a God-fearing home. They were to provide, Joseph's role is to provide and protect for Jesus, kind of provide for Jesus as he was growing up. It's a huge honor, but you think about how it would tear about their lives. This would allow the Savior to have a great foundation in which to launch his public ministry 30 years later. And so you think about that. God caused Joseph and Mary's life to be really turned upside down. Think about it for Mary. Maybe she's scared to death. This is her future husband. What is he going to say? What's going to happen to me? I'm going to be shamed, publicly humiliated because of this situation. We don't think about that often. What is he going to do? But what we see in Mary is this. She completely trusted God. In Luke chapter 1, verse 38, after she has an interchange with the angel Gabriel, she says this at the end of the thing after Gabriel explains to her, and they have a little back and forth about what's going on. Look at her heart, and I love this. And Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Let it be according to your word. She's a willing, humble servant, even though her life, now, think of the story, maybe you can think about it, but think about the fear for this young lady. She's probably gonna lose her husband. Who knows what's gonna happen in that society then, if you were unfaithful, be caught in adultery. This is life-shattering for her. She'd be publicly shamed, if not worse. maybe could be legally put to death. And she has all this weighing on her shoulders, and the angel comes to her and says, well, this is a mission from the Lord, trust me. And what did she say? Okay, Lord, I trust you. We make plans, and God makes plans. And often they seem harsh for us, but in reality they aren't. Look at Joseph, all his plans are now wrecked. All his plans, that mission, he's gonna go back to Nazareth, they're gonna start their business, start their family together, now it's all gone. In his mind, he's gone, but the angel comes and reassures him to make sure it's not. He says, my wife is with child. How, why? Why would this happen to me? You can imagine that. My marriage and my plans are now in ruins. But the angel comes to him, and look in our story, we see his reaction. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and he took his wife and knew her not. He did as the Lord. Their lives are totally upended, and what was their response? Okay, Lord, we trust you. We'll do it. We'll just move forward and figure this out. But what's neat is God doesn't leave us hanging out. We've gone to this verse a couple sermons ago in Romans chapter 8, and it's verse 28, and you guys are familiar with us. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose, all things work together for good. They knew that inherently in their heart. They wouldn't have known this passage per se, but they're living this out in real time. Just trusting that what God's plan for their life is better than what they thought they were gonna have. And that God needed them to carry this burden, and they were willing to carry it. I think we can learn a lot from Joseph and Mary's example as we move forward. Think about the uncertainty to trust that we see. Look at verses 19 and 20 back in our passage. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not take Mary as your wife. From that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. We see that Joseph was equipped to handle difficult situations. This is a terribly difficult situation. This is a public humiliation, or worse. But notice Joseph's reaction to that. He wasn't concerned with his position, wasn't concerned with what was going to happen to him. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, his only concern was Mary, wasn't about him. You see the humility in this. You see the humility in Mary. You see the humility in Joseph. And ultimately, you see the humility in Christ, who humbles him, comes down. But I think it's a beautiful. See, Joseph's a man of integrity. He's a just man, which means he'd be upright and honest. Just wanted to do what God wanted out of it. He's trying to live the best he could. He's anxious to do the right thing. Notice he wanted to do the right thing. He didn't wait for it to happen, but he wanted to initiate what was right. He was wise in handling the problem. You can see that there's some forethought in this. I need to divorce her quietly, so we just put this away quietly, try to maintain her honor the best we can, and kind of just protect everybody involved. Joseph was trying to resolve the problem in a godly way. He's trying to resolve this problem, this horrific problem he initially feels, in a godly way. And I think too often we get difficulties or maybe problems in our lives, and we try to sort them out our way, and instead of trying to figure out how can I resolve this problem, this conflict, in a godly way. And we see that in Joseph right out the gate. And you can see why Joseph and Mary were chosen carry this cool plan. We see that Joseph was trying to really resolve the problem in a godly way. He's trying to protect Mary, and he's trying to uphold God's commands. He's not trying to get to the result. He's trying to uphold God's commands as he goes. I think that's important. Notice what God does. Because Joseph is going to carry this huge burden, God reassures. When you pursue God in the right way, he'll reassure you. It'll come in various forms. Maybe somebody that comes and encourages you to see it in real life. Joseph got visited by an angel, but he got real-time guidance on what was going on. He was considering what to do, being trying to be thoughtful about it, but yet he wasn't fearful about what the answer was be. And the angel gives him direction. He says, look, this child is special. This child has a mission, has a bigger purpose. And it seems short here, and it is, but this information that's given, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife. Verse 21, she will bear a son and she'll call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophets. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. That's Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, is where this passage comes out. And this is a promise. So he verifies what's going on. He verifies a special mission, that it's God with us. And that's how God changes, and that's how what God uses to change all of us. This difficult situation can be navigated in a way that honors God. Difficult situations in our lives can be done in a way that honors God. Our problems can be navigated in a similar way. How does God's word address a situation? Dealing with a difficulty? What does God's word say about it? What does God say about what's going on here in your life? Is my heart right with God? Often we know what God wants us to do when a difficult situation comes up in our lives, but we're ticked off and mad about something, about the situation, so we try to manipulate God's word to fit our side, to defend our position, rather than look at it in a way, is what I'm doing honoring God? I think that's something that we can see and learn. Our plans turn out better when God is involved. God's plan for Joseph and Mary were so much bigger than they could imagine. At first, they thought maybe all their plans were ruined, but as you see the story comes and it starts to fulfill, God's plan for their lives is much, much bigger. It's the same for God's plan for mankind. He sent Jesus to fix our sin problem. The birth of the Savior triggers a series of events over the next 33 years that put us in a position to start that relationship with God. He starts it by sending his son. The whole term is Emmanuel, means God with us. The idea that God is hanging with us and is part of our lives is important. We see that in this passage, we see, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. This is a beautiful concept, God with us. This is a huge moment. And we see, too quick on my pages here, sorry about that. We see that when we pursue God's plan for our lives, our way becomes clear. I think that's important for us to understand. Kenton, this morning, he was opening one of his gifts. He got to the back of his pile, and it was a big, big box. And the boys ask us for stuff, so we get different things. And he'd asked for a certain thing for when he goes back to school. But he didn't realize what it was, and it was a big box. And he got all excited about it. He's like, I don't know what this is. And he's trying to open it. He's like flabbergasted because he felt like his list was pretty well filled out. And so he was really funny about it. He looks at the box, and it's like a simple human box, something on there like that. And he's all excited about it, and he tears into it, and all it was a trash can for his room, for his bedroom back at college. He's like, oh, that's the trash can I wanted. But it was funny because he was so excited, and then he was like, oh, it's not as exciting as I thought. And then he's like, oh, I'm happy with my gift. Often that's what happens. We get gifts that disappoint, right? Life disappoints often sometimes, and it can be hard. But what's interesting to see is we see Joseph and Mary, they went through all this uncertainty, but they just trusted God. And because of their character, put them in a position to handle this. And we see executing God's plans is important. We need to enact God's plan in our life. God's plans are often different than ours, but what's neat about them is they're more fulfilling. I know in my own personal life and walk, and you've heard my testimony, I was on a plan that was totally different than what God wanted. But that plan that God wanted incorporated things that were exciting to me in a way that magnified them, made them so much better. Our plans turn out better when God is involved. God's plans for Joseph and Mary were so much bigger than they could have imagined. God's plan for mankind to fix our sin problem by sending his son to save us from our sins. We call him Jesus, which Joseph called him Jesus when he was told to, which means Jehovah saves. God saves. Right from the get-go, this is really kind of probably the first time the term being saved is used. It's to build his kingdom through the life-changing power of his son. That's what God sent down. He wanted to build God's kingdom through the work of his son. The work of the son changes people. These believers, the weak, are empowered to build the kingdom. As we start that relationship with Jesus, we start to learn what God wants us to do, and then we start building the kingdom. And more people are saved and stop from spending an eternity in hell. And isn't that really, at the end of the day, what it's all about? We talked about a week or two ago about how that your relationship with God, if it doesn't change you, what's it all for? If your walk with God doesn't change you, what's it matter? We see in the story of Joseph and Mary as they react to the birth of the Savior, and they had to carry this huge burden, and there would be more burdens for Mary. If you think a couple weeks ago when we talked about the passage that when the shepherds came, that she cherished this information when the people would come and worship, but that would pierce her heart someday when he's hanging on the cross. They would carry this burden throughout their whole life. This whole plan that they had seemed to be just live the Israeli dream, so to speak, this Jewish dream, but yet God had so much bigger plan for them. I think it's the same thing in each of our lives. By celebrating Christmas and coming and celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ is so important. We focus on him and what he does, but let it change our lives. Let it change our daily walk. Don't let it be something we focus on at one time of the year. Let our lives, our relationship with God, gather momentum for our lives. So we're trusting him in everything that comes through. There's going to be good times in our lives, and there's going to be hard times. And those hard times are tough, and we know that. That's why God says, look, trust me. I've got a plan for those hard times. It's going to work out for good, and I don't know how to, each situation's different, right? We don't know. But God works through those situations for good. We know our time here is short. Let us impact those around us. There's so many people that are hurting. There's so many people that don't know their purpose in life because they haven't accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. There's so many people that are empty, and they're looking, and they're longing, and they're filling it with all kinds of things that will never mean anything at the end of the day. Life is short. It goes by quick. If you're a believer here this morning, use the momentum of Christmas and let it spill over into New Year's. We always make New Year's resolutions, right? We're going to exercise more. We're going to eat less. We're going to do whatever you're going to do, right? A couple years ago, I tried to learn Spanish. It lasted about 8 months, and I realized I didn't even speak English well enough to learn another language. I still try, but it's terrible at it. Right? We try these things, but why can't we just try trusting God every day from now until next Christmas? Won't that be our new mission? We're just going to try to trust God from now until next Christmas. Let the story of Christmas be more than today. Let the story of Christmas be more than a few days with friends and family. Enjoy this time with friends and family. Enjoy your time with your spending time today with family or the next few days. Enjoy it, cherish it, because next year it'll be different, right? But let's take our walk with Christ every day, and let's impact those around us and draw them in to hear and respond to the love of Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, again, we'll humbly come before you. We know that your plans are different than ours. Sometimes we think we're going to do certain things, and when we trust you, you kind of twist them and move them to the direction that really fulfills us in a much more powerful way. As we see the birth of your son, Jesus, it's really, at the end of the day, it's about belief and trust, isn't it? That's what you've impacted us with. I ask you would help each one of us here this morning, that we would just fully trust you, that we'd fully give our lives to you. We ask you would change our momentum, help us to be excited about your kingdom, be excited about what you do in our lives, and help that excitement just spill over into our community. We ask you to just use every believer in this nation to just change people around us, work through us in a powerful way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. While the choir's coming up, they're working their way up. I'm gonna try to get this candle lit. Mark, can we turn off some lights? We didn't get to do the candlelight last night, so we thought we'd try it this morning, because it's fun to sing Silent Night. And I'm going to see if I can actually get my candle lit. It would be a miracle, wouldn't it? Ooh, there it is, Christmas miracle already. Play nice. Well, we appreciate you guys coming this morning. As we finish, we'll sing Silent Night. Mark, can you hit the headlights here? Drop all the lights, as many as we can. There we go. Not too bad. And as always, don't catch each other on fire. I know, nobody likes my kind of fun, though. That's true. Anytime you have live fire in a church service, there's always a chance for a lot of fun, quickly.
Oh,
Thanks for coming. Merry Christmas. You guys have a great afternoon. And blow out your candles, throw them in the... Oh, the box is gone. Oh, the box is up here. I'll take it to the back. I'll beat you to the back. Thanks for coming this morning. Choir, you guys did a great job. Thanks for all the practice this month. You really blessed us this morning. Thank you.
And
you guys have a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.